Hello everyone. Okay, today we will discuss about session 4. So first topic in the session 4 is a typical embedded system. Okay, so the typical embedded system contains single chip controller which acts as a master brain of the system. The controller can be a microprocessor like 8085, okay, or a microcontroller, okay, or field programmable gate array. In short, it is called FPGA device. Example, in the last semester we used Xilinx, wherein we chosen the option called Spartan. It is called Xilinx Spartan, one of the type of FPGA, okay, or a digital signal processor. In short, it is called DSP, or an application specific integrated circuit. In short, ASIC or ASIC, or application specific standard product, ASSP. Okay, analog devices for energy metering applications. So these are all an example which are the part of your embedded system. Embedded hardware software systems are basically designed to regulate a physical variable or to manipulate the state of some devices by sending some control signal to the actuators or devices connected to the output ports of the system in response to the input signal provided by the end user or sensor which are connected to the input ports. Now it looks very difficult to understand this phrase because you are not used to it. I'll give a simple example. Nowadays we are using many embedded devices. Like if we give any input to it, it will give some kind of output. So something like if we are working on some healthcare systems wherein we are used to check the patient's temperature. So a sensor will sense the temperature of a patient and gives output to a LED or LCD display. You can imagine about this one. Okay? So this is one of the embedded system. A typical set of elements of an embedded system can be visualized as input ports, which can be a sensors, output ports, which can be actuators, okay, and other supporting integrated circuits and subsystem in between them. So it may be FPGA, ASIC, DSP, SoC, microprocessor or controller. We may have some other benefit of embedded system as a memory on a board. Then we have some interesting things wherein we can connect an embedded system to the outside world through communication interface. These embedded systems nowadays are very smart enough. They don't require any manual intervention for their operation nowadays. So everything is now automated. I hope you heard about IoTs, smart devices. Okay, so they work by themselves remotely. Even I spoken about that in earlier classes. So in this part of the module, we were going to see a lot of information about the hardware present on the embedded system, okay, from memory to the processor to the sensor to the actuators. So we'll see in detail about those things. It's very crucial and very important from the perspective of embedded system. Next topic is core of embedded system. The embedded systems are domain and application specific, are built around a central core. The core of the embedded system falls into any one of the following categories: general purpose and domain specific processors, which may include microprocessor, microcontroller, digital signal processor, in short DSPs. Second category is application specific integrated circuit, in short it is called ASICs. Third category is programmable logic devices, in short it is called PLDs. And very interesting, fourth category is commercial off-the-shelf components. In short, it is called COTS, COTS. Now we will see one by one about them. First one is general purpose and domain specific processors. Almost 80% of embedded systems are processor or controller based. The processor may be microprocessor or microcontroller or digital signal processor, depending on the domain and application. I hope you attended the class wherein I discussed the difference between microprocessor and microcontroller. This topic again coming now, so I hope you go through once again that topic and you look at the PPT what I shared, so you can add some more points to it. So I will save the time the discussion on that one. Any queries you can get back to me. Now I'll speak on general purpose processor versus application specific instruction set processor. Okay, so a general purpose processor or GPP is a processor designed for general computational task. The processor running inside your laptop or desktop is a typical example for general purpose processor. Whereas application specific instruction set processor, in short it is called ASIPS, are processors with an architecture and instruction set optimized to specific domain or application requirement like network processing, automotive, telecom, media applications, DSPs, control applications, etc. Next is digital signal processors are powerful special purpose 8, 16 or 32 bit microprocessor designed for specifically to meet computational demands and power constraints of today's embedded audio, video and communication applications. A typical digital signal processor incorporates the following key units: program memory, memory for storing program required by DSP to process the data, data memory, working memory for storing temporary variable and data signal to be processed, computational engine performs the signal processing in accordance with the stored program memory, IO unit acts as an interface between the outside world and DSP. It is responsible for capturing signals to be processed and delivering the processed signal. Next subtopics are RISC versus CISC processors. Again, we discussed in elaborate about this one in the class. So I hope you go through my PPT. Again, you update yourself. Any queries, you can come back. One more topic is Harvard versus Von Neumann architecture. Again, we have discussed in the class about this one. So I hope you go through my PPT again. You come back with any queries. Now next subtopic is Big Endian versus Little Endian processor controllers. The endianness specifies the order in which the data is stored in the memory by processor operation in multi-byte system. So about this one, we have discussed in brief in the class again. So I'll just highlight two points which are related to Little Endian and Big Endian. So higher order of data byte at a higher memory and lower order of data byte at a location just below the higher memory is an example of Little Endian. Lower order of data byte at higher memory and higher order of data byte at location just below the higher memory is the example of Big Endian. You can see in my PPT, there is one example wherein we have 4 bytes of memory how the things are stored. Okay, so you go through that PPT, you'll understand Big Endian and Little Endian. Next subtopic is load store operation and instruction pipelining. Okay, the concept of load store architecture is very interesting. You can go through my PPT again once again, wherein I'm using 4 instructions to show how the load store will work. Okay, again we know this load store architecture, it will benefit or it makes the execution faster, okay, compared to the other instructions. Now we know the pipeline concept. Again, I will not spend the time on this one, okay, but I am sharing one image wherein you can see how the clock pulses in a single stage pipelining will work. Okay, I hope you go through those things wherein we have machine cycles, okay, fetch execute and fetch execute cycles, how they are working and how many PCs it is taking. PCs means program counter. Okay. Next topic is application specific integrated circuits. In short, it is called ASIC. It is a microchip designed to perform specific or unique application. It is used as a replacement to conventional general purpose logic chips. It integrates several functions into single chip and thereby reducing the system development cost. ASICs are proprietary products. The developers of the such chips may not be interested in revealing the internal details of it, and hence it is very difficult to point out an example of it. Moreover, it will create legal disputes if an illustration of such an ASIC product is given without getting prior permission from the manufacturer of ASIC. Next is PLDs, Programmable Logic Device. Logic devices provide specific functions including device-to-device interfacing, data communication, signal processing, data display, timing and control operation. Almost every other function a system must perform. Logic devices can be classified into two broad categories, fixed and programmable. As name indicates, the circuits in a fixed logic device are permanent. They perform one function or set of functions once manufactured. They cannot be changed. On the other hand, programmable logic devices offer customer a wide range of logic capacity, feature, speed, and voltage characteristic, and these devices can be reconfigured to perform any number of functions at any time. The two major types of programmable logic devices are field programmable gate arrays, FPGAs, and complex programmable logic devices, CPLDs. Of the two, FPGAs offer highest amount of logic density, the most features and the highest performance. The largest FPGA now shipping part of Xilinx, which we used in the last semester. CPLDs, by contrast, offer much smaller amounts of logic, up to about 10,000 gates. But CPLDs offer very predictable timing characteristic and are therefore ideal for critical control applications. Some of the advantages of PLDs, such as they offer customer much more flexibility. PLDs do not require long lead times for prototype or production parts. PLDs allow customers to order just the number of parts they need when they need them, allowing them to control inventory. PLDs can be reprogrammed even after a piece of equipment is shipped to a customer. Last topic in core of embedded system is commercially off-the-shelf component. In short, it is called COTS. Product is one which is used as is. COTS products are designed in a such a way to provide ease, integration and interoperability with existing system component. The COTS component itself may be developed around a general purpose or domain specific processor or an application specific integrated circuit or programmable logic device. An example of COTS, I can say hardware unit or remote controlled toy car control unit, including the RF circuitry part, high performance, high frequency microwave electronics, high bandwidth analog to digital converters, devices and components for operation at very high temperature, electro-optic IR imaging arrays, UV IR detector, etc. The advantage of using COTS is that they are available in the market, are cheap. A developer can cut down development time to a greater extent by using them. This is in turn reduces the time to market your embedded system, one of the very important application of COTS. The drawback of using COTS component is in embedded system design is that the manufacturer of COTS component may withdraw the product or discontinue the production of COTS at any time if a rapid change in technology occurs. This will adversely affect the commercial manufacturer of the embedded system, which makes use of specific COTS product. Next topic is memory. Memory is an important part of processor controller based embedded system. Some of the processor controller contain built-in memory, and this memory is referred as on-chip memory. Other do contain any memory inside the chip and require external memory to be connected with the controller to store the control algorithm. It is called off-chip memory. Now let us look at different types of memories used in the embedded system. It's a very vast discussion, so I hope you keep your finger crossed till we complete the discussion. So first one is a program storage memory. In short, it is called ROM. The program memory or code storage memory of an embedded system stores the program instructions, and it can be classified into different types as shown in the block diagram in my PPT. Just go through that. So I'll see one by one about that one. So first I'm taking is masked ROM. In short, it is called MROM. Masked ROM is a one-time programmable device. Masked ROM makes use of hardwired technology for storing the data. The device is factory programmed by masking and metallization process at the time of product itself. According to the data provided by end user, the primary advantage of this low cost for high volume production. They are least expensive type of solid state memory. Masked ROM will be or is a good candidate for storing the embedded firmware for low cost embedded devices. Next type of memory is programmable read only memory. In short, it is called PROM. One more name to this one is OTP. Unlike masked ROM memory, it is known as one time programmable memory, that is OTP. Okay. The end user is responsible for programming these devices. This memory has nichrome or polysilicon wires arranged in a matrix. These wires can be functionally viewed as fuses. I hope you seen the fusibility kind of thing in the designing of PAL, PLA, PROM in ADE subject. Okay, hope you remember that one. Next type of memory is erasable programmable read-only memory. OTPs are not useful and worth for development purpose. During the development phase, the code is subject to continuous changes, and using an OTP each time to load the code is not economical. Erasable programmable read-only memory or EPROM gives the flexibility to reprogram the same chip. It requires UV eraser. UV means ultraviolet erasers for 20 to 30 minutes, and it is very time consuming process. Next is electrically erasable programmable read-only memory, that is called EEPROM. As the name indicates, the information contained in EEPROM memory can be altered by using electrical signal at the register or byte level. They can be erased and reprogrammed in a circuit. These chips include a chip erase mode, and this mode can be erased in few milliseconds. Next we have very interesting, which is latest one, that is flash. Flash is the latest ROM technology, and it is most popular ROM technology and used in today's embedded system. Flash memory is a variation of EEPROM technology. It combines the reprogrammability EEPROM and the high capacity of standard ROM. Flash memory is organized sectors or pages. Flash memory stores information in an array of floating gate MOSFET transistors. The erasing of memory can be done at sector level or page level without affecting the other sectors or pages. Each sector or page should be erased before reprogramming. Next we have NVRAM. Non-volatile RAM is a random access memory with a battery backup. It contains static RAM based memory and a minute battery for providing supply to the memory in the absence of external power supply. The memory and battery are packed together in a single package. The lifespan of NVRAM is expected to be around 10 years. Next topic is read-write memory or RAM. RAM is a data memory or working memory of a controller processor. The controller processor can read from it and write to it. RAM is volatile, meaning when the power is turned off, all the contents are destroyed. Okay, this is known fact. Okay, Now we have different categories of RAM, such as static RAM, dynamic RAM, and non-volatile RAM. Okay, the static RAM stores the data in the form of voltage. They are made up of flip-flops. Static RAM is a fastest form of RAM available. In a typical implementation, a SRAM cell is realized using 6 transistors. Particularly, these transistors are MOSFETs, metal oxide field effect transistors. 4 of the transistors are used for building the latch. Latch again, it is a flip-flop, part of the memory cell, and 2 for controlling the access. Again, in PPT, I have shown the SRAM cell implementation. You just go through that one. From the figure, it is evident that the memory cell is controlled by a line word line, which controls the access transistor Q5 and Q6. The access transistor control the connection to bit lines B and B. In order to write the value to the memory cell, apply the desired value to the bit control lines and assert the word line. Major limitation of SRAM are low capacity and high cost. Since a minimum of 6 transistors are required to build a single memory cell, imagine how many memory cells we need to fabricate on a silicon wafer. Next is dynamic RAM or DRAM. Dynamic RAM stores the data in the form of charge. They are made up of MOS transistor gates. The advantage of DRAM are its high density and low cost compared to SRAM. The disadvantage is that since the information is stored as a charge, it gets leaked off with the time, and to prevent this, they need to be refreshed periodically. Again, from the figure, we can see DRAM cell implementation, wherein MOSFET acts as a gate for the incoming and outgoing data, where the capacitor acts as a bit storage unit. So the table in the PPT, again, you can see that there is a difference between SRAM cell and DRAM cell. I hope you go through that one. Next type of memory is NVRAM, that is non-volatile RAM. It's a random access memory with a battery backup. It contains a static RAM based memory and minute battery for providing supply to memory in the absence of external power supply. The memory and battery are packed together in a single package. Memory according to the type of interfaces. The interface or connection of memory with processor can be of various types. So some of the types include I2C, SPI, one wire bus. So about these three topics we will discuss later when we go in a topic called communication interface. Okay, so we'll hold for this one. Next is memory shadowing. Generally, the execution of program or configuration from a read-only memory is a very slow compared to execution from random access memory. From the timing parameters, it is obvious that RAM access is about 3 times as fast as ROM access. Shadowing of memory is a technique adopted to solve the execution speed problem in processor-based systems. In computer systems and video systems, there will be a configuration holding ROM called Basic Input Output Configuration ROM, or simply BIOS. In personal computers, BIOS stores the hardware configuration information like address assigned for various serial ports and other non-plug N-play devices. About BIOS, we have discussed in the class again. Memory selection for embedded system. Okay, the embedded system require a program memory for holding control algorithm or embedded OS and the application designed to run top on it. Data memory for holding variable and temporary data during the task execution, and memory for holding non-volatile data which are modifiable by applications. For embedded system with low power requirements like portable devices, choose low power memory devices. Certain embedded devices may be targeted for operating at extreme environmental conditions like high temperature, high humid area, etc. Select an industrial grade memory chip in place of commercial grade chip for such devices. Writing summary for this topic may not be possible in single page. You make according to your wish, whatever may be the pages, but you take only one pick and upload. Thank you.